you had a good lunch, or at the very least aren't hungry at the moment. It's a somewhat terrifying privilege for me to be in conversation with Mridula Garg, whose reputation I imagine precedes her. We have decided that although Mridulaji's work has largely been in Hindi, to have this conversation in English, if that's all right with everyone. There's a moment in one of Mridulaji's novels in which a character says, tell me, can a woman be called a feminist just because she's hugely stubborn? And it seems to, and Mridulaji's work is often called feminist. It's it's perhaps one of the definitive feminist canons, her corpus of work in modern Hindi literature itself. But one of the reasons for that is because it comes at the question of questions of womanhood and feminism in spiky, sharp, surprising ways. Women can be hugely stubborn. Characters can be dauntless. They can be restless. They can be impatient. They can most certainly be unlikable. And with all of this, with these fully human, marvelously complex literary qualities, the question of whether the characters are feminist or not becomes irrelevant. But the woman writing them certainly, paved a feminist path and paved new ways of writing and thinking and working as a woman in literature. She's also a crystalline stylist, both in Hindi and in English, into which she has translated some of her own work and in which she wrote her last novel. She's a political thinker who has very little regard for fear or favor. She's a satirist. As I discovered when I read her work, she is one of India's most challenging and enjoyable literary voices. But before we introduce you to Mridulaji's literary life, in keeping with the title of this panel, why don't you hear a little bit from her work? Mridulaji, will you tell them a little bit about the story that you're reading from, and I'll just take this out. And this bit will be in Hindi.
There are two stories of mine published in the first 5 years of my writing career, in Hindi of course, which became sort of synonymous with my name. One was called Daffodil Jal Rahe Hain, and in English it was called Daffodils on Fire. It was published in Illustrated Weekly in translation. And the other story was Hari Bindi, which again has been translated in many languages, including Croatian. And of course, the one novel for which I was notorious or famous, whatever you want, was Chit Cobra, which I will, at the end of it, I'll read a one page from it. So you may, I'm going to read a short passage from Daffodil Jal Rahe Hain. आम तौर पर हिंदुस्तान में डैफोडिल नहीं होते अच्छा है आम तौर पर जो मिल जाए उसका मिलना क्या मिलना फिर भी एक जगह होते हैं और मैंने पहले डैफोडिल वहीं देखा गुलमर्ग में पीले रंग का बड़ा सा फूल चार पंखुड़ियां और बीच में कटोरा सा सब पीला नहीं है मतलब डैफोडिल देखने से पहले नहीं था पर डैफोडिल देखकर लगा कोई हर्ज नहीं है चलेगा पीला रंग भी चलेगा डैफोडिल की तरह हिंदुस्तान में आमतौर पर हनीमून भी नहीं मिलता अच्छा है बहुत से लोग एक भुलावे से बचे रहते हैं वरना ये वक्ती बहिष्ट जमीन पर जहन्नुम के एहसास को कुछ और तीखा बना डालता है मेरी शादी सुधाकर से हो चुकी थी सुधाकर और मैं कॉलेज में साथ पढ़ते थे हम एक दूसरे को बुरे नहीं लगते थे सुधाकर को नौकरी मिली तो उसे लगा अब शादी कर लेनी चाहिए मैंने बीए पास किया तो मुझे लग रहा अब नौकरी क्या करनी सीधे सीधे शादी कर लेनी चाहिए। सुधाकर ने सोचा होगा बीना क्या बुरी है, मैंने भी सोचा सुधाकर क्या बुरा है, जाना पहचाना आदमी है, 3 साल साथ रहा, बुरा नहीं लगा। शायद इसी को प्रेम कहते हैं, और जो अब तक नहीं लगा आगे चलकर क्यों लगेगा, लगा भी तो औरों की क्या गारंटी है, यानी बुरा तो कोई भी किसी वक्त लग सकता है। एक दिन पिक्चर देखकर बाहर निकले तो सुधाकर बोला वीनू मुझसे शादी करोगी, मैंने कहा कर लूँगी, हमारी शादी हो गई। संयोग कुछ ऐसा था कि सुधाकर और मैं एक ही जाति और प्रदेश के थे, दोनों बनिए और दोनों उत्तर प्रदेश के, लिहाजा ना उसके माँ बाप ने अड़ंगा लगाया ना मेरे माँ बाप ने, खुशी खुशी दान दहेज का सामान खरीदा, मेहमान जुटाए और पंडित जी से फेरे डलवा दिए। प्रेम विवाह हुआ भी और अपने शहर से भाग कहीं परदेश जाकर चोरी छिपे शादी करने का रोमांच तक नहीं मिला। शादी होते ही सुधाकर बोला हनीमून के लिए एक ही जगह है, कश्मीर, वहाँ के लिए बुकिंग करा ली है। मुझे भी चलना होगा, मैंने पूछा। सुधाकर बोला तुम्हारा सेंस ऑफ ह्यूमर बहुत अच्छा है। ऐसा नहीं हो सकता था हम शादी से पहले कश्मीर भाग जाते, मैंने कहा, सोचा तब होता कोई रोमांच। अरे जब हमारी शादी में कोई बाधा नहीं थी तो वहाँ जाने की क्या ज़रूरत थी, सुधाकर ने पूछा। मैंने कहा हाँ ज़रूरत तो नहीं थी, अब क्यों है। अरे सारी ज़िंदगी यहाँ दिल्ली में पड़े पड़े सड़ना है, कुछ दिन तो जी लें, कश्मीर को सब लोग पता है स्वर्ग बतलाते हैं, स्वर्ग तो सारी ज़िंदगी अच्छी तरह तैयार करने के लिए हम लोग कश्मीर चले गए।
Supriya, thank you very much for reading from that story. As much as I'd like to ask you about it specifically, I think we should stick to, or at least let us pretend to stick to the theme of this and be very broad. So I'll begin, if you don't mind, with a biographical question. Can you tell us about how fiction and literature first entered your life?
I had actually done my master's in economics and I was teaching economics in Delhi. And then I got married and my head of the department kept telling me you should not marry a man who lives in Dalmia Nagar because marriage should have place utility. So at that time I just laughed at her. I said, oh, she's a really senile character. But later on I realized that it was very important. Place utility was very important. Once I reached this small place in Bihar, there was no college there, there was no school there, there was no hospital there. Whole dream of doing my PhD in economics and going on teaching economics was went kaput. My husband did offer that I could continue to live in Delhi and sort of go to Dalmia Nagar during holidays, you know, because in college you get a lot of holidays. But strictly speaking, I was not in love with teaching. After 1 or 2 years, I had started finding it quite boring. So this was a very good opportunity. You know, I was a martyr. I was giving up my job. I was going from Delhi to a small place, so small that I could not even imagine it, you know. When we reached our house, I thought that this is some place where we are going to spend the night and tomorrow we will go to our house. Then only I realized, no, this is the house. And he had asked his friends to put a matka of water in the house to welcome the new bride. That's about the about all. So anyway, I slowly got used to it. And had I not lived in Bihar, I would not have become a writer. Because the first thing I realized there was that all the economics that we had been taught about underdeveloped economies and this and that was all totally wrong, impractical. It did not apply to this place, which was truly India, which was underdeveloped rural India. And all my knowledge and everything just, you know, it got ulta-pulta, stood on its head. And then I started, actually I did a lot of plays there. We also did a play in which we made a lot of money for the famine relief there. And we started going to the villages and carrying food, cooked food with us. And you know, that sort of, we learned about villages, we learned about nutrition. How can you, with very little money, you know, take nutritious food to people? And we learned about the pride of the people. They were not willing to take anything for free. And only we had to beg them to eat, literally. And we took cooked food because we felt that, you know, to provide everything separately was more difficult. This was easy for us women to cook and take. But we then developed friendships. In fact, one Lambadi family grew very friendly with me. And Lambadis are very close people, you know. They don't allow anybody to come to their temples and things like that. She even lent me her dress, which I wore for a fancy dress, and did my hair and all that kind of thing. And I realized that I can't write. I mean, I can't write on economics because I feel that it is fake. So then that was the time when, though I have hardly written any story on Dalmia Nagar as such, only later in the novel I have recalled Dalmia Nagar in great detail. But from Dalmia Nagar, I went on to other small places like Durgapur, which was not that, it was quite sophisticated. And then to another primitive place in Karnataka called Bagalkot, which most of you have not heard of. It was between
from where beautiful Hobli saris come. From where beautiful saris come.
Ilkal saris come from, Ilkal. Ilkal is a small village there from which these saris come, on which Kasuti is done, Karnataka Kasuti is done. I have written one story about that. About Karnataka, I have written a lot of stories because by that time, all that I had learned in Bihar had come to fruition. So basically, you know, I just sat down one day and wrote a story on letter pad paper, blue it was, I remember. And I wrote with hand, and my writing is nothing to speak of. And I shot it off to Kamleshwar, who was the editor of Sarika. And he wrote back to say, okay, I'll publish this story, but how do I know that you will write more? So in response, I sent him 20 stories over the next 2 years. So he knew I'll write more. And anyway, then, you know, these stories were sent to various magazines and all that. So I don't know what made me write, excepting that when I had my children, I suddenly felt there was some kind of a, you know, Rachnatmak Visphot, something creative, avalanche kind of a thing blew me away. And I went at that time to Dharwar with the idea of taking my admission to PhD, and I happened to be at Girish Karnad there. And he put me off PhD completely because he had done all that he had done, and after that he was writing in Kannad. So I said, to hell with it, I came back and I started writing in Hindi. And I wrote a few stories and poems in English first, I remember. One story was published in Illustrated Weekly. But suddenly I found, you know, that I can't play with language. Somehow, when I wrote in English, language was commanding me. When I wrote in Hindi, I could just do what I wanted with language. However much people might criticize me about it, Jainendra ji told me, whatever people say about language, don't pay any attention. So I could just experiment with language, though I was not, it was not that I was using an Anchalik or anything, just Khadi Boli.
Right.
But the voices were different.
And at a time when your experiences had made your academic work seem fake and unreal, you found the truth in fiction and have continued to do that ever since. Which is why I think when you came to Goa a few years ago, your session was called Fidelity to Fiction.
Yes. Yes, exactly.
As someone who moved around quite a bit and, you know, sent stories to Kamleshwarji on inland letters, what was your first sense of literary community? How did your sense of readers, critics, editors, you know, a kind of mirror that every writer needs, how did that form?
I was very fortunate. I was in this godforsaken place, Bagalkot, and no Hindi writer or critic or anybody had ever seen me, excepting in the photographs which came out in magazines. And I didn't know about the politics which goes on in Hindi, about the various groups, nothing. I thought they were all very grand, wonderful people who wrote wonderful books.
And all of this was happening in Delhi, which was the epicenter.
Epicenter was Delhi and Mumbai, also right. Mumbai. Dharmyug was in Mumbai at that time, and Dharmyug was the epicenter of everything. And then I remember Dharmveer Bharti wrote to me saying that when you come to Bombay, do meet me. And Shripat Rai, who ran Kahani, you know, this was an interesting thing. I sent a story to Kahani, and Shripat Rai wrote back to me saying that if you permit, we will include this story in a competition. I didn't even know there was a competition. So if the editor says so, then you will get the award. I mean, obviously. So I got the first prize in that story. And so many letters came. That was my first interaction with readers. That, and at that time, people used to write letters.
This was in the early 70s.
Early 70s.
Right.
And then, 75, I wrote my first novel. And in the first 10 years, I wrote either a novel or a short story collection I have published every year. And because all that was already there, you know, somebody said, one of the critics said, she's not a new writer. Because all this she could have written 10 years ago. But at the same time, I must tell you one thing about criticism. You know, when my first novel was published, one review said that, one man said, and he seemed very pained, and he said, I cannot spend my life living with Mridulaji's characters, women characters. They think too much, they argue too much. They are too restless.
So your fiction did in fact show truth to some of your male readers. Mridulaji, your work, all your work across forms, what I know of it, gives a wonderful impression of crispness and pace. And when we spoke last night, you did say that when you write short stories, you often write them in one sitting. And clearly that was how you began your career, as your story of the Inland Letter shows us. What was the But you can't write novels like that, right? So what was the transition from being a short story writer to being a novelist, which happened for you in 75, like?
You see, I had written quite a lot of stories by then. And you can hear me, no? Yeah. I'm loud enough. Anyway.
Yeah, I think this is just for the recording.
Okay.
Yeah.
So basically, I think everybody was telling me to write a novel. All my editors. And then I hit upon a theme. I was just talking to somebody and I said that if so-and-so was married to you, she would have been in love with somebody else. And now that she's married to somebody else, she's in love with you. It's as simple as that. And then this was the theme of my first novel.
Right.
That the woman divorces her husband, goes away with another man, and then after 4 years, she meets the first husband and finds that well, he was a fine person, and what she took for indifference was really his magnanimity. He was not a kind of a husband who would sort of, you know, try to possess you or run your life, and he allowed her so much freedom, in fact, that he was almost unavailable. But she was very angry about that at that time, and now she felt, with a possessive husband, she felt that she was in great need for freedom. And then, of course, after all, she concludes that it's no use running from one man to another. It doesn't lead to anything. You have to achieve whatever you have to achieve. You have to feel whatever you have to feel within yourself. So you have to develop everything within yourself. Any man would do or not do.
Right.
So that is was the how the first novel got written.
Right.
But before the novel, I had written a play. And that was, you know, these people come, na, we call them dunya, dunka, who come to people's houses and then they do the razai again, the quilt.
Right.
They redo the quilt, they dun, dun, it goes. So with that as the background, I wrote a play called Ek aur Ajnabi, in which was portrayed, which of course I didn't know the word for it, a live-in relationship, so to say. I mean, there's a doctor in it who leaves her husband and lives for 2 years with a poet, and she says all she wanted was avkash. All she wanted was some free time. She had nothing against her husband, and She doesn't know whether she'll go back there or go somewhere else, but this was just Avkash. She was not going to marry this poet. And naturally, I mean, it didn't really anger people as much as Chitkobra did later on. I'm surprised, why not? Excepting that it came on All India Radio, it was translated in all Indian languages, and I used to get a check of 160 rupees almost every week for his rebroadcast, you know. But when the same play was to be done on TV, it was banned by the director. And all the big actors were going to act in it, you know, Uttara Bhavkar and Surekha Sikri and all. So they all got after me that I should go and talk to the director. I said, I felt it was not my business to talk. I mean, it was a departmental matter. But anyway, I went and asked him why he had banned it. He said, your play makes people think.
Right.
So first he said, your play is against the institution of marriage. So I said, what is your vested interest in marriage? And then I said, you had broadcast a play in which, you know, a woman asks a jinn to get her another man because her husband's very boring, this and that. No, 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 that's all right, he says. Your play makes people think. So thinking is not allowed.
Right.
Particularly women should not think. And he had the guts to ban it, like on that issue.
Right.
He bans the play. So it was never done on TV. And even when it was done on stage, you know, most people couldn't digest it, so to say. Now if it's done, of course.
It's an unfortunate quality of all your work that the women in it think.
They think
and seems to force its audience to think. The conversation you just quoted about Uske Hisse Ki Dhoop, in which a woman says, oh, if I wasn't married to you, I'd be in love with you know, if I was married to you, I'd be in love with the man who's my husband, is echoed almost exactly in a key moment in Chitkobra, which is the novel that you just mentioned, and which, for those who aren't familiar with it, is an exceptional work and stands on its own in the canon of modern Hindi literature for a variety of reasons, but was also a news-making novel, has often been called the Hindi Lady Chatterley's Lover, which earned Mridulaji some very interesting criticism, including state-sponsored. Mridulaji, at what point were you made aware of the idea that your writing was shocking or radical in some way?
For me, there was nothing shocking in it at all. I thought it was very sattvic, so to say.
Right?
This woman was talking about love, yaar. What was the problem? I could not understand. And in fact, in a seminar in Lucknow, I remember I told the... I mean, to the extent to get me arrested and all that, it was ridiculous.
Right, which is what happened to her in 1980, a year after the novel came out.
So I told these all the great authors sitting there in, you know, Kathakram is a literary event in Lucknow, which is a lot of writers are there.
Right.
I said, why did you people start criticizing Chitkobra? All you had to do was to go home and ask your wives. They would have told you. If they had lied, then also you would have known. If you had told the truth, then also you would have known. So of course that made me even, I mean, that certainly did not earn me any brownie points. But I could not understand why people were so thin-skinned. And what was the problem? And later on I could only analyze this, that again the problem was that the woman was thinking. She was not thinking of her lover while she was with her husband. She was just thinking in general.
Right.
And this thinking business is very difficult. Because it made her husband what men love to make women feel like, a body. And that is intolerable for a man's ego.
I know the reaction to Chitkobra and the case against it was perhaps the most... is perhaps the most famous and outlandish criticism that you've gotten. But women are always, as we've just discussed, women are always thinking in your work. Love, unusual forms of love, dissatisfactions with marriage, adultery, infidelity. These are all themes to which you've returned time and again. And it's not that these are necessarily new themes in literature or even in Hindi literature, right? So was the problem that you, a young woman, was writing about them? Was that what was intolerable to...
Well, a young woman writing about it and not asking for any kind of patronage from men.
Mm-hmm.
And then the women thinking cerebral creatures, you know, not only sensual creatures. And then I also threw in a few political things, you know.
Hmm.
I wrote a novel called Anitya.
Right, which, this was explicitly
was
political.
Which was in 1980, and I think at that time it must have been the first criticism of Gandhi. It was, it talked about Bhagat Singh and Gandhi, and criticizing him not for what he was, but just this dilemma that he created in people's minds about between violence and non-violence, which they could not resolve, and it ended in such horrible violence at the time of partition. So basically what I was saying was that people had not changed despite their following Gandhiji and truly loving him and doing everything. At heart they had not changed, and there is a seed of violence in people, and Pandit Nehru has said that and has disagreed with Gandhi about this, that violence is quite normal, but we, of course, we can sublimate it. That's a different matter. So that novel, in the beginning, you know, that novel earned a lot of reviews, good reviews, this and that.
Right.
But what happened was that after that, I wrote a novel called Kat Gulab.
That was in 96, right?
96.
Right.
Which was about feminism, so to say.
That's right.
Very openly. So after that, I was made a feminist writer. And they only talked of three novels of mine, and they would never talk of Anitya. And there's another novel of mine called Main Aur Main, which I think is my best novel. And it's about two writers, one a man and a woman, and one very well off and all that, and the other very a genius, but he believes in just cheating everybody. He says, since the society has cheated me, I have every right to cheat everybody.
Mm.
I mean, he's a, what is called a psychopath, you know. He never feels any guilt at any action of his. So that novel hardly ever people talk about in Hindi.
Mm.
Anitya also, they've stopped talking once, you know, I became the feminist writer.
Right.
And if I say I'm not, everybody's angry with me. The feminists are very angry with me.
Mm.
Because my women don't get empowered in that way. Na? They don't kick out their husbands and they don't sort of become prime ministers. So it's all in the mind, you know. They think differently, they behave differently, but they don't really achieve very great kudos. So it's very confusing.
They're unpredictable
it's confusing
women.
For people that an unpredictable person, and there are all stereotypes are broken.
Hmm.
So that is not a very comfortable situation to be in. In fact, I feel that whenever people write anything truthfully, it makes people very angry because it makes them uncomfortable. They feel we were fine with all the values, everything. Now who are you to question that and make us see things differently? So I think it's a very good thing for a writer to be able to invoke anger in people, and to some extent disagreement,
right,
of a very virulent kind, you know, that who are you to tell us, and you are this, you are something must be wrong with you, you know, family must be wrong. And then we are three sisters who write in
yes.
one family. So there's obviously something wrong with the family. So it is that kind of a thing. It is basically my persona combined with my writing.
Right.
That is what makes people angry, I feel.
Can we, since you brought up Anitya, which was an explicitly political project, as you said, did that make people angry? Did you feel like you were alone in Hindi literary circles?
No, not at all. In fact, the Gandhi, you know, I did a lot of research on it.
Right.
And I had all the Zabt books and all that, and I read everything, including Nathuram Godse's last speech and everything. And when I wrote it, the Gandhians did not criticize it at all.
Right.
They were very sweet about it, very magnanimous. The people who criticized it were the Marxists. And because I had criticized Soviet Union also, and what I said was true, later on Soviet Union recognized it, that they had sold Czechoslovakia to Germany. I mean, they had opened Czechoslovakia to Germany. And all that was true. Mm. But at that time, and I read Churchill's memoirs and Second World War, books on Second World War, every damn thing. So later on, it was proved true, but the Marxists were very angry. Mm. And it was the Marxists who criticized the book. I was amazed. The Gandhians never criticized the book. Mm. And they found a lot of good in it. That was the greatness of the Gandhians, you know, because they, Jenny Indra, Vishnu Prabhakar, people, all the writers who were Gandhians, and even the other people, and of course the people like Manmathnath Gupta and all, they were revolutionaries themselves, so they were happy with it anyway. Mm. But I did not feel alone the way I did with Chit Kobra.
Right.
Anitya was not like that. Mm. Some people criticized, it's fine. I mean, I'm fine with criticism.
Right.
After so many years, I am myself ready to criticize Anitya on many counts. But the point is this, that they did not make me feel that as if I have done something wrong. And gradually, only thing is that this way, the more subtle way was to stop taking its name.
Right.
And make me a woman's writer. So, uske se ki do, Chit Kobra, Kat Gulab. These are the three novels. And even Main Aur Main, because it's a confusing kind of a thing where a man is cheating a woman of her money, of her aptitude for literature, of a lot of things to fuel his own creativity, and the woman in turn is using him for her creativity. So this was a little more complicated. So this they thought was not feminist.
Right.
So they left it.
What I'm getting both from what you've said about your relationship with, you know, with a certain strain of the feminist movement and with and politically, is that you've spent your career making making the doctrinaire very upset.
Yes. Mm. Even now, I mean, whenever I write, I'm a perpetual dissenter. So whoever governs, I dissent.
Right.
I mean, a great principle of equity. Whoever is in governing, and because in our country, whoever governs is corrupt, so it makes it very easy also to, you know, be against. But it's on a matter of, it's on principles. I'm not just criticizing for the sake of criticism.
Right, understood.
But I had a lot of fans also. I mean, I don't want to create the impression that I've been just reviled and all that. I've been loved a lot, and I have been read a lot. People have been ready to take up, you know, cudgels for me that, no, this book is very good, it's not like the critics are saying. So I've had a lot of readers, lot of fans, so it's good.
Yes, of course, and you know, just from 1980, when, as you said, you were arrested for being a writer of obscenity, you went on to become, you know, a state awardee, someone who, as you said, was widely read, and someone who found herself perhaps willy-nilly in the position of representing Indian writing and Hindi literature and so on the world stage very often. How do you feel about, you know,
your faults are forgiven? They gave me the Sahitya Academy when I was 75, thinking now she cannot commit anymore. So the point is that I think once in a while they give an award to a person who is not very much in support of them to prove how
magnanimous
and matlab nishpaksh hote hain. They are not prejudiced, they
right.
are very democratic people. So they give these awards once in a while. I also got them, but basically I think the main award is the readers. And ordinary readers. I've just now, somebody's been writing to me about my novel Miljul Man,
right?
She has taken leave from office to read it because she wants to read it at one go. And then she has written a very beautiful letter on it. And her name is Menon, so I was very happy that some Malayali person is reading it. Then she said, no, that's a spelling mistake. I'm a Punjabi.
This is like the Nair conundrum.
So I said, acha, anyway, that is reason for more happiness. So actually, you know, when I write a novel, I think it's not very different. The process is not very different from a story. because I don't keep any journal, I don't keep any diaries, I don't note anything, I don't write any synopsis. It's all in my mind. And when the first sentence strikes me, I start writing. And then it goes, I mean, the characters, the protagonists take it where it goes. Sometimes I'm very angry also that this is not what I want to write. But it's not in my hands, kind of. It just goes on.
Right.
So that way, you know, my creative process is very exhausting for me because I then just live with the people, you know. I remember when I was writing Anit there, my sons asked me that, you know, why people don't come to our house now? Because you're forever talking of 1942, 1930, 1932. Right. Nobody comes here now. They were very angry. Said, live in the present. So I get very involved with my characters, and whatever is happening in life gets transferred to the novel. That's what happens. So it's more or less like a story. Only thing is I live with it longer.
You do. I'm going to ask you one more question, and then perhaps we can give our audience a chance to ask you a couple, as jealous as I am of your time. You brought up Katkulab, and since we were talking just now about, you know, kind of the uncomfortable relationship you have with a certain kind of with a certain imposed idea of what a feminist story should look like. The men in all your stories occupy very interesting positions. And Katkulab, which is a story in which five different voices narrate the novel, one of which is a man who brings the novel to a conclusion. If you have the chance to read it, please do. It's the sense that you also write men with an extraordinary sympathy, you know, and as fully human in their own right rather than instruments.
Yes. Many men in my novels are very sensitive people and very with the feminine principle in them. In fact, the man in Katgulab is purely Ardhanarishwar. That is the concept. And all the other men are really evil people in it, villains. But this one man then saves everything, you know. The women who have become very self-possessed,
preserving in some ways.
Conceited and self-obsessed kind of people. And the men who have been harassing and punishing women for everything that they cannot achieve. So all those, in a way, that Vipin, that character then becomes a foil to. And
right, he overturns.
Overturns them. So I think we can ask the audience.
Right, yeah. We're happy to pass the mic to any of you, should you have questions. We're not impatient, but if you have a brief question, that would be excellent. And if you don't, I have more questions. Yes, sir. Sir, your question need not be brief.
Don't make me self-conscious. Mridulaji, one thing that I'd like you to speak about, you've spoken, all as always, extremely candidly and so on. You may be one of the first writers in Hindi fiction to have a major role in some of your novels for foreign characters. Would you like to speak about that? Foreign
characters.
Yes. I mean, it was very, for me, the first foreign character was in some stories. The first one was Chacha. Achha, sorry. It's all right now.
Yes.
I think I had not switched it on. The first one, which is I talked about it, Hari Bindi, was a man she meets accidentally. A woman goes to see the movie and a man is there who happens to be a foreigner, and they meet for a very few moments, have a cup of coffee together, and after that they neither ask each other anything nor do they ever meet again. But those moments are very precious to them. So this happened basically, I think, because I wanted to show distance. And also somebody who would not fit the stereotypical Indian man, which most people, when they read his story, they would expect that man to be like that. Gradually, I could portray Indian men also as different. But also, I think when I moved around, I met a lot of foreigners, both women and men. In Kathgulab, there is, of the five, four women, one woman is an American. And I could write about her, and I then said that if you can write something, you should write it. So there are things which only you can write. Now, only Manohar Joshi could write Hamzad. So he should have written it. That is my idea, you know. So only I could have written Chit Cobra. So I should have written it. Same way there is this character Marian. You know, Harish, because of what people were always saying, that Western sensibility, this and that, when I wrote Kathgulab, I did not write Marian. When the whole novel was completed, I wrote Marian later and then incorporated her. And everybody but everybody, all the diehard Hindutvawalas liked Marian best. So basically, you know, because I felt an affinity with these characters, that's why I brought it in. And partly also because a distance is created. You are in presence of somebody you're not likely to understand fully. And that is very interesting. There is a mystique to it. That was also the reason. And I have gone around a lot of countries, and I've always been a spectator, kind of. I have not been educated there, I have not taken part, I have not worked there, but I have observed, and I have had friends. That's the reason.
Thank you. And thank you for the daffodils, another foreign character. Do we have other questions? No, the daffodils themselves are. I don't know if we have... we'd like, in that case, to end the session also with Mridulaji's words, and she's going to read from Chit Cobra, her 1979 novel.
I'm going to read the last page of Chit Cobra, which will make you understand that all the criticism was wrong about this book. Mere hum safar, ye dekho samne mood hai, us par mur jao, abhi mauka hai, aage nikas nahi milega, wapas lautna padega. Achha nahi lagega na, safar mein lautna koi nahi chahata. Dekho, kitna ghumavdar mood hai, iska rujhan chaudi sarkon par hai, tum us par ghoom jao, thandi sadkon par safar karo, tumhara safar shaad ho. Mera saath chhodo, is sadak par jo aata hai, uske haath sirf bhatkan lagti hai. Jante ho, ye safar anthin hai. Abhi tumhe dikh nahi rahi, par kuch hi duri par thos diwar raasta roke khadi hai. Chaho to us par sir de maro, chaho laut jao. Chalo aur lauto, chalo aur lauto. Lakshyahin, aakarshan vihin, shunye ki lambi virani par chalo aur lauto. Do char ped jo the sukh gaye, itni tez dhoop hai ki aankhein chaundhya rahi hain, aas paas ka dikhna band hota ja raha hai. Haan, agar is sadak par ped lagaun, na sahi mera bhavishy auron ka to hai. Jao ab tum jao, mujhe is veeran sadak ke dono kinaron par ped lagane hain, kal ke naam par, har kshan ki yaad mein ek ped. Kuch varshon baad tum yahan aana, ye shahar ki sabse chhayadar sadak hogi. Chaho to kisi ped ki chhaya mein baithkar meri kahani yaad kar lena, par aana tum tab jab mera bhatka safar khatm ho chuka ho.